I'm Thomas W. Dortz, Jr., Chairman and Founder of the National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame Foundation. And on behalf of the Board of Directors, it is my honor to welcome you to the 35th Annual Hall of Fame Induction Ceremony. My task today is easy. I'm here to introduce a living legend in the media. She's been a permanent fixture for us over the last few years. She's received 33 regional Emmy Awards for her reporting, and of course, her interview of the late Congressman John Lewis received national attention. She's a graduate of the University of Georgia with a master's degree in journalism and communications. Again, she retired in 2012, at least she thought she did. But today she is just as active and just as engaged in our community on radio and television. She's a mentor, she's a phenomenal leader, she is someone we always look up to. Please welcome the one and only Monica Pearson, who is our mistress of ceremony for the evening.
Thanks. I was so excited when they asked me to host again this year. Tommy Dortz is one of my favorite people, and I'm honored to join in the celebration of Black college graduates. Well, we're opening our program tonight with what has been called the Negro National Anthem, performed by a talented saxophonist known around the world, Mike Phillips.
Thank you.
my pleasure to be with you on this special night as we celebrate and honor many of our HBCU graduates. This event promotes the viability of HBCUs and highlights the accomplishments of their alumni. The foundation is pleased to announce its stellar class of 2020, who will be inducted into the NBCA Hall of Fame, joining over 300 previous inductees. Here to bring our invocation is Reverend Gerald Durley.
Thank you very much, Monica Pearson. And I want to certainly thank Mr. Thomas Deutsch and the National Black College Hall of Fame for all of the great alumni. Today is a very special day in your life. In 2007, I was inducted into this august body of alumni all over the world. Today, you're being inducted into a great group of elite scholars, athletes, scientists, politicians, lawyers, and faith leaders all over the world. The historically black colleges and universities have always been the hallmark of what we as a people have done. We are the soul of a nation, but it started right at our institutions. I never thought that I would be where I am today, and I wouldn't have been there had I not been a Tennessee State University graduate. Starting there over 60 years ago, it has meant so much. And all of you today who are being inducted from all of your universities and colleges, you too will go forth and join a group of scholars all over the nation and the world. So I'm so pleased to have been here. But one of the things that we learned in all of our learning and all of our character building and all of our ethical and moral development was that nothing began without prayer. There was always a connection to prayer when we wondered how we were going to make it. Would the financial aid come through? Would we like our roommate? Did we like our room? Where were we going to get a haircut? Where was our worship experience going to be? And we could always depend on a God that never failed us. So as we go into this induction ceremony, this very special moment in your life, please join with me as we invoke the presence of God. Eternal and almighty, divine, righteous God, the giver of every good and perfect and excellent gift, it is once again at this time you've appointed your people to come together under this august body to induct honorees, honorees who will go forth and change the world, honorees who've already demonstrated what they can do in their various capacities. So God, we ask now that you would continue to bless each one of them, bless their home, bless them with health and strength and prosperity, joy. God, give them the happiness that they so eagerly deserve. God, we thank you for this time. We thank you for this hour. We thank you for every person that will receive this award today. Let them understand that this is just a step on the journey that will make a difference in the lives of so many people that they will come in contact with. So now, God, we bless this service. We bless these awards. We bless these who are presenting the awards. And we bless this organization. What a wonderful group. God, we thank you for your love and for your might. And we pray it in the name of all the great saints, but in particular in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Let us go forth to serve. In that name we pray. Amen.
It's become a tradition here at the Hall of Fame induction ceremony to sing. Here to perform is Sharon Jenkins, Miss NBCA Hall of Fame 1991.
Maya Angelou and Sharon co-authored musical rendition of And Still I Rise.
You may write me down in history with your bitter twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still like dust, I rise.
A bit of twisted lies. You may trod me in the very dirt, but still like dust I rise. Does my sizeness upset you? Why are you beset with gloom? Cause I walk like I got oil wells pumping in my living room. Yeah, like the moon's a
The National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame is grateful to sponsors who've been with us for more than 30 years. We will now hear from our partners and sponsors.
Sometimes our differences seem big. Sometimes our differences seem small. Sometimes it seems we don't share much at all. But take a broader perspective. The more you go out and see this world of ours, you'll find that our similarities are just as remarkable as our differences. In Delta's 300 cities around the globe, we've seen it's less what language you speak or what you believe in. It's who shares the same goal, that of trying to move us all forward. Aboard the biggest flight of all.
This is how you turn a house into a home your children's kids can someday own. This is how empowered becomes empowerful.
Georgia Pacific invests in organizations that seek to break down barriers to education, ensure equal justice, address persistent poverty, and promote understanding between people of different races, backgrounds, and perspectives. Our vision of a just society, where everyone has an opportunity to reach their full potential, is at the heart of our people and our work. As committed corporate citizens, we'll continue to do our part to fight for the equal rights for all and an unmovable belief in the inherent dignity of every person.
Now for the moment we've been waiting for, our first honoree in the arts category is Ms. Laverne E. Washington. Ms. Washington's incredible career in communications and music blossomed at Langston University in the mid-1970s. In 1978, Ms. Washington was crowned Miss Langston University. She later was featured as the first Langston University queen to grace the cover of Ebony magazine, which is now on permanent display at the National African American Museum of History and Culture in Washington, D.C. Throughout her dynamic career as a vocalist and musician, arts grants manager and producer and entertainment consultant, Miss Washington has created memorable musical experiences for audiences large and small. In 2019, she authored and self-published her first book, Angels of DuPont Circle, and is now working on a 2020 album release of her original music. A devoted member of her community, Miss Washington is committed to serving the youth and providing scholarships for Langston University students.
Good evening, everyone. First, I'd like to give God the glory for this esteemed award. And let me thank the National Black College Hall of Fame Foundation for this award and what it represents. I'm humbled by the greatness of those who have been honored before us, and I'm always happy to represent my Langston University. When I received your letter with the news that I had been chosen as an honoree, I was filled with great pride and truly thankful. I also want to send my thanks to the person who took the time to submit my name, Langston's own Vonnie Ware. I'm sending all my best to the president of Langston University, Kent Smith, the staff, including Martra Jones, faculty and students. I was asked to speak a little about my arts and entertainment background, and I just wanted to say a little bit about it. After graduating from Langston, I spent some years recording and performing throughout the Midwest and the South. I was later hired by the top arts agency in the country, the National Endowment for the Arts. It's the top agency that provides grants through all of its programs and disciplines. We funded many artists' dreams, also artists working through organizations as well as radio, film, and television, including many PBS shows. A decade later, I was blessed to work for the Rhythm and Blues Foundation, providing assistance and work opportunities for legend R&B artists of the 1940s through the 1970s. We provided grants for food, medical, housing, and also, unfortunately, paid for many funerals. A decade later, as an associate producer for over 10 years at the R&B Foundation, I worked along with the board and staff to produce the yearly Pioneer Awards in New York, Los Angeles, and Philadelphia. The gala was held every year during Grammy Week. It provides them with a monetary award and a night that celebrates just them. It was a blessing working with them all. Once again, I thank you, and I hope to meet you all in the coming year. I know I've got to keep it short, but I'd like to quickly do a little bit of a song I wrote for the 100th anniversary celebration of Langston University. And I pray that they continue educating our young for 100 years more. God bless. Ooh, yeah. While we celebrate you, congratulations. We celebrate you. Congratulations to all the other honorees. And I'm gonna keep going, and they're gonna just fade me out. I'm so proud to be a graduate of Langston University, high on a hill. Such royalty, yeah, mere words cannot provide how Langston touched so many lives and mine. The story's been told and will never grow old. I just want to say congratulations. For 100 years, you've been giving back and sharing history. Congratulations for teaching us the truth. We know the truth. You can do anything. Pass every test at Langston University. We learn it from the best. Be anything you want with pride and dignity. The world is there waiting for you. Congratulations. We celebrate you. Thank you so much.
Our next honoree is our athletics inductee, Dr. Walter L. Reed. Dr. Reed is a pioneer and visionary who has always valued the significance of education. He received his Bachelor of Science from Jackson State University, a Master of Science at Indiana University, and a Doctor of Education at the University of Miami. Dr. Reed has been involved in all levels of athletics throughout his career. He has served on several NCAA and NAIA committees, as well as chaired the NCAA Division I AA Football Committee. Throughout his impressive career, Dr. Reed has received multiple awards, such as the Education Professional Development Act Fellowship, honored as the Man of the Year by Phi Beta Sigma Fraternity Incorporated, and named twice as the Southwestern Athletic Conference Athletic Director of the Year by the NCAA, and has been inducted into the Mississippi Sports Hall of Fame, Jackson State University Sports Hall of Fame, and that's just to name a few. Presently, Dr. Reed is the president of the Central Mississippi Chapter National Football Foundation, board member of the Jackson Touchdown Club, All-American Football Foundation and chairperson of the Jackson State University Sports Hall of Fame Selection Committee. He serves as a deacon at Mount Helm Baptist Church in Jackson and is a family man with three children, four grandchildren, and one great-granddaughter with his wife, Martha.
I would like to express my appreciation to the National Black College Alumni Association Hall of Fame for looking at Walter Reed as one of the persons that made such a contribution to sports and education within the black colleges that I would be given consideration for such a prestigious award. This award is one that I will cherish for the rest of my life, and I want everybody to know that it is the highest award that Walter Reed will expect to receive during his lifetime. I'd like to thank the selection committee for looking favorable up on my application. I'd like to thank everyone that was involved in this and let you know how much I appreciate it. I've had a great career when it comes to working in education and being an educator from the elementary school throughout the university level. Some of the things that have happened to me while I was an athletic administrator was that for several years, when we first joined 1AA, I was the athletic director at Jackson State University for 11 years, and at least 8 of those 11 years, we led 1AA in attendance. We were one of the first HBCU, one of the two HBCU schools to participate in the first 1AA playoff, which was won by Florida A&M University, the only HBCU to ever win that award. I've been fortunate enough to serve on several NCAA committees, especially the executive committee, the 1AA football committee, where I served as a member for years and served as the chairman of the committee for 2 years. I served on several committees within the Southwestern Athletic Conference and the Mid-Eastern Athletic Conference, and was fortunate enough to be selected to go in each one of those two conferences Hall of Fame. I was also in 1999 selected for the Mississippi Sports Hall of Fame and the National Athletic Directors Association Hall of Fame. Those are some of the awards that I've been for, some of the people that honored some of my accomplishments throughout my working career. I was fortunate enough to work for three great presidents, Dr. John A. Peoples at Jackson State and Dr. James A. Hefner at Jackson State, and for Dr. Frederick Humphreys at Florida A&M University. These three presidents looked at Walter Reed as one that could run an athletic program and be successful. Out of all of my career, 17 years as an athletic director, never came in the red. We always had a positive balance at the end of the year. I was fortunate enough to work with some of the greatest coaches to ever exist within black colleges, W.C. Gordon, Martin Epps, Paul Covington, Robert Brady, Ken Riley, Robert Mumford, Bobby Lane, Willie Booker, and Ken Lucas. I was able to work with guys of that nature. Was fortunate enough to, at this junction of my life, to be able to join some great Jacksonians in the National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame, namely John Peoples and my college roommate, Dr. Roderick Page. It's an honor to be here, and I'm very appreciative of what you all have done for me. I'd also like to say that the young lady that's been with me and been very supportive of everything that I've always done, and we've been together for going on 64 years, and she's been supportive, and that's my wife, Martha, and my three kids, Clifton, Kathy and Walter A., my four grandchildren, Kayla, Walter A.C., Sydney, and Jared, and the love of my old life, my great-granddaughter, Waverly. I thank you. Another thing that I feel like that was a great assistance to me as it relates to, I was athletic director at Jackson State when Jackson State played its first game in Memphis, Tennessee, where we hosted Tennessee State in Memphis, Tennessee in the Liberty Bowl. And it has now turned into the Heritage Bowl and is one of the outstanding HBCU bowls throughout the country. I was also fortunate enough to be the athletic director at Florida A&M University when Florida A&M and Tennessee State played in the first Atlanta Classic under the auspices of the 100 Black Men of Atlanta. I was fortunate enough to be the athletic director at FAMU when we played in each one of the major stadiums in the state of Florida and was very competitive as it relates to drawing in those stadiums because we moved the Orange Blossom Classic from each one of the stadiums in the state of Florida with the exception of Tampa Stadium where we played Bethune-Cookman each year. Florida A&M was a great institution to work for. Dr. Fred Humphries was a great president to work for. And I'm just honored to have had the opportunity to work for three of the great educational leaders at HBCUs within America.
Congratulations. Our next recipient is Dr. B. DaNine Fleming, our community service inductee. Dr. Fleming graduated magna cum laude in 1996 from Claflin University with a bachelor's degree in elementary education. Her scholarly pursuits led her to earn a master's in early childhood education from the College of Charleston and an educational specialist degree in educational leadership and administration from South Carolina State University. Dr. Fleming received her doctorate in educational leadership from Youngstown State University. She is a founding member of the Advisory Council for Taking Back Our Village, a youth anti-violence community program, and started the Little Book Lending Library program at Flowertown Elementary School. She has served three terms with the Berkeley County School District Health and Physical Education Advisory Council. For the past 10 years, Dr. Fleming has been the executive director for the McNeil Foundation for the Awareness of Domestic Violence and Abuse. Most recently, Dr. Fleming received the 2020 MUSC Foundation Teaching Excellence Award and is an associate professor at the Medical University of South Carolina. She is also the founding senior partner for the Nevea Group, focusing on assisting corporate and educational clients achieve diversity and inclusion goals. Dr. Fleming is a life member, state officer, and a past chapter president of the Zeta Phi Beta Sorority, Incorporated.
I am honored and humbled to be nominated for such a prestigious award. I do not deem it robbery to say thank you. Thank you to everyone that has made this a reality. Thank you to my beloved Claflin University family for nominating me, a Black woman from rural Givehand, South Carolina, from humble beginnings that had a vision that was enhanced by the Claflin confidence and now lives within the Claflin magic. I am my grandmother's legacy, the late Mrs. Olitha Jones Jenkins, a 1942 graduate of Claflin University, was one of my role models. She and my grandfather carried me onto the campus before I knew who I was. And as they were working to assist with raising money for scholarships and working within the community, all I knew was community service growing up. Although my grandfather only had an eighth grade education, he supported my grandmother's dreams, and they both knew the value of community building and serving as the village. The first African-American woman in Congress, the Honorable Shirley Chisholm, said, "Service is the rent that we pay for the privilege of living on this earth. And my family instilled this in me at a young age. I am first a servant, and it will always be my desire to sow seeds into the community, our community, my community. So if it's with Zeta Phi Beta Sorority Incorporated on global initiatives, serving as a founding member of the Taking Back Our Village community organization in historic Lincolnville, the oldest Black settlement in South Carolina, working in unity with local leaders and law enforcement on solutions to bring an end to senseless gun violence, the McNeil Foundation for the Awareness of Domestic Violence and Abuse, providing educational opportunities for young people in all communities via the Little Book Lending Library, or working to increase the awareness of food insecurities, especially in marginalized communities, by sponsoring Low Country Blessing Boxes with the theme, take what you need, leave what you can, but above all, be blessed. This is my calling, and to be recognized for doing that which I consider to be my reasonable service warms my heart. I stand upon the shoulders of giants, many who may go unnamed, ancestors that persevered and did so much more than I will ever. Every student that has ever graced the grounds of an HBCU and knew as they entered that they were finally at home. I would like to thank the National Black College Alumni Association for this amazing program, your commitment to excellence, as well as your investment in leaders. Has not gone unnoticed. Thank you.
Our next inductee is Dr. Glenda Baskin Glover, the education inductee. Dr. Glover began serving as president of Tennessee State University January 2, 2013. She was formerly the Dean of the College of Business at Jackson State University in Jackson, Mississippi, where she led the College of Business throughout the accreditation process and spearheaded the implementation of the nation's first PhD in business at an HBCU. She is a certified public accountant and attorney and is one of two African-American women to hold the PhD, CPA, JD combination in the nation. Her educational development began as a student at Tennessee State University, where she majored in mathematics. After graduating with honors with a Bachelor of Science degree, she pursued the Master of Business Administration at Clark Atlanta University. She then completed her doctorate in business from George Washington University and later completed her law degree from Georgetown University. Prior to joining Jackson State University, Dr. Glover served as chairperson of the Department of Accounting at Howard University. Dr. Glover has been a corporate board member of three publicly traded corporations. She is the author of more than 100 articles and papers and is regarded as one of the nation's experts on corporate governance. Dr. Glenda Glover is also the national president of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, Incorporated. And for the last 2 years, under their HBCU initiative, she has raised more than $1 million in their one-day campaign.
Thank you for this prestigious honor of being selected into the National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame. This is one of the most significant awards I have received in my professional life. It is very special to me because of the importance of HBCUs to our educational system and to the country in general. As an HBCU president at Tennessee State University, I see firsthand the challenges of Black colleges, and I have committed to do all in my power to contribute to the sustainability of HBCUs. We seek to expand educational possibilities for higher education. Serving HBCUs is a privilege that I don't take lightly, because leadership is no more than a privilege to serve. I am grateful to the Board of Directors of the Hall of Fame for bestowing such an honor. Thank you very much.
Our next inductee is in the field of entertainment. Tonight's inductee is Ms. Mara Hall. Mm-hmm. Mara Hall's multifaceted success as an actress, musician, teacher, writer, and producer is awe-inspiring. To say the least, a Jackson State University graduate, Mara was a member of their renowned marching band, better known as the Sonic Boom of the South. She played the tuba, the clarinet, and after receiving her bachelor's degree in music education, she went on to teach and become the associate band director at Alcorn State University. Her passion for music led her to receive her Master of Music degree in clarinet performance at the University of Cincinnati College Conservatory of Music. Mara Hall also explored her artistic passions by pursuing acting. She has landed roles in numerous productions such as Grey's Anatomy, Scandal, and more recently, Ambitious, the Oprah Winfrey Network's nighttime drama. She's also a writer and producer and is developing Juicy Ladies, a film selected for the Langston Hughes Black Film Festival. Mara is also an adamant advocate for diabetes awareness, keeping the arts in schools and teaching the next generation. With over 20 years of performance and teaching experience, Mara Hall is just getting started.
Hi, I'm actress Mara Hall. You've seen me as Nurse Kathleen on Grey's Anatomy, Major General Owens on Scandal, and currently as Darcia Lancaster, the cousin you love to hate on Ambitions. I would like to say thank you, thank you, thank you to the National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame for honoring me and having me here today. First, I'd like to thank my alma mater, Jackson State University, for nominating me for such a prestigious award. A special thank you to Dr. Alexia Norwood, JSU National Alumni President, and my Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated Gamma Rho Chapter Soror for thinking so highly of me and recognizing my accomplishments and love for my alma mater. I would also like to thank Tammy Brooks, Executive Director of Jackson State University National Alumni Association Incorporated. A special thanks to the Jackson State University Sonic Boom of the South Marching Band Family and the glamorous Gamma Rho Chapter of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated Spring 1996. Thank you to my former band director, Dr. Louis Liddell Sr. for providing me with a full music scholarship in 1994. My parents, John and Dale Hall of Detroit, Michigan, for being my strength and my light. My daughter, Marley Nicole Hall Brightson, JSU class of 2038, for giving me vision and purpose. My best friend, Dr. Carl Cunningham Jr., aka Dr. Set It Off, for surviving the last 25 plus years with me and the Tiger Nation around the world. The I love. I accept this award on behalf of my late brother, fellow Jacksonian, Jason Anthony Hall. I can't wait for spring 2021 when JSU hits prime time. And I welcome Dion Coach Prime Sanders to the JSU Nation. Go JSU Tigers, I believe, the I love.
Our next inductee is the Honorable Reverend Dr. Jamal Bryant. Dr. Bryant is an outstanding visionary, civil rights activist, community organizer, businessman, and a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He uses his undeniable gifts to propel the body of Christ to action and greater levels of faith. He's a third-generation minister and was the founding pastor of the Empowerment Temple AME Church in Baltimore, Maryland. Prior to pastoring his first church, he served as the National Youth and College Director of the NAACP, mobilizing over 70,000 youth worldwide in nonviolent campaigns. His ability to reach across social, economic, and political barriers has helped people experience the life-changing gospel of Jesus Christ and activate success in their everyday lives. In December of 2018, Dr. Bryant was appointed the senior pastor of New Birth Missionary Baptist Church in Lithonia, Georgia. His leadership has strengthened the multi-generational bond among members, expanded community outreach, and emphasized the church's cultural significance.
I am honored and delighted, humbled, to be able to receive this award from the National Black College Hall of Fame to be inducted. Today, I want to receive it on behalf of my late grandfather, Bishop Harrison James Bryant. Coming out of the tobacco fields of Georgetown, South Carolina, he went back to the sixth grade at 27 years of age, completed his education, and Wilberforce College in Ohio took him in, even though he didn't meet all of the requirements. He changed the landscape and the trajectory of education in my family. And if it were not for him, I wouldn't be here on today. The old R&B song says, no matter how high I get, I'll still be looking up to you. In the middle of a pandemic, in the center of a pandemic, I'm honored and I'm grateful, but I would be irresponsible if I didn't now pass the baton to another generation who comes behind me to realize that greatness is found in HBCU alumnus. If it were not for Howard University, we would not have the very first black vice president in this nation's history. I'm excited about our future, and I'm grateful for our past. Keep rising.
The Honorable Alma Adams is our government inductee. Congresswoman Alma Adams is a strong advocate for all HBCUs and her alma mater, North Carolina A&T State University. She began her political career in the 1980s by becoming the first African-American woman elected to the Greensboro City School Board. Since then, she has honored her lifetime commitment to effecting social change in her community and beyond. In 1994, Congresswoman Adams was appointed by her peers to serve in the North Carolina House District 26 seat. She went on to serve 10 terms in the State House and went on to found and co-chair multiple caucuses, such as the North Carolina Legislative Black Caucus, Congressional Bipartisan HBCU Caucus, Congressional Black Caucus, and more. Throughout her career, Congresswoman Adams has promoted equality and quality education for all students and spearheaded legislation to increase funding for HBCUs, providing nutritious breakfasts in schools and supporting increased pay for teachers. Congresswoman Adams was inducted into the Charlotte-Mecklenburg Women's History Hall of Fame, received an honorary degree from Lincoln University, honored by Governor Roy Cooper, and awarded the NCA&T Human Rights Medal. One of her most notable achievements includes the passing of the Future Act, which Congresswoman Adams co-sponsored, being passed by the U.S. House of Representatives in 2019. The Future Act permanently guarantees $255 million a year for HBCUs, preparing students for careers in the STEM profession.
Hello, I'm Congresswoman Alma Adams. To the National Black College Alumni Board of Directors and your chairman, Thomas W. Deutsch Jr., thank you for this amazing honor. As someone who has long believed in the power and impact of historically black colleges and universities, I am honored to be inducted into the National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame. I bring you greetings on behalf of the more than 800,000 constituents of North Carolina's 12th Congressional District. And from my colleagues in the House of Representatives, Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi, Majority Leader Hoyer, Majority Whip Clyburn, Minority Leader McCarthy, and 55 members of the Congressional Black Caucus, I greet you as well. My mother always believed that an education would be my passport to opportunity, and indeed it has been. I was a first-generation college student, like many of our students enrolled today. I was raised by a strong mother who didn't have a chance to get an education. She didn't finish high school, wasn't able to attend an HBCU, or any CU for that matter. My mother did domestic work. She cleaned white folks' houses, so I wouldn't have to. We were poor, but we were rich in our vision for the future. So today, that poor black girl who grew up walking the ghetto streets of Newark, New Jersey, is now able to walk the halls of the United States Congress as a member of the House of Representatives. But that journey began at an HBCU. When I arrived on the campus of North Carolina A&T State University as a freshman, I had very little money and certainly was not prepared academically to do college work. But they took me where I was and helped me to get to where I needed to be. They saw my potential and began molding me into what they knew I could become. And it was because of an HBCU in Greensboro, North Carolina, that I was able to go on to get my PhD from the Ohio State University, but only because of the North Carolina A&T. I've made it my mission to ensure that HBCUs have the resources needed, not just to survive, but to thrive and remain beacons of hope for current and future students. For this reason, I started the Congressional Bipartisan HBCU Caucus when I was first elected to Congress. I wanted to create a national HBCU dialogue and expand visibility and support for our students and our schools. Education is a fundamental right. And as W.E.B. Du Bois so eloquently stated, of all of the civil rights for which the world has struggled and fought for 500 years, the right to learn is undoubtedly the most fundamental. And so it is with gratitude that I accept this most distinguished honor of induction into the National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame and offer congratulations to my fellow inductees. Thank you and God bless.
Our next honoree is in the industry category. Mr. Leroy Thornton Edwards, the owner and CEO of the Edwards Companies. He began his career at 20 at Procter & Gamble in Cincinnati, Ohio. He received his bachelor's degree with honors from North Carolina A&T State University in 1972 and an MBA from the University of North Carolina at Greensboro in 1974. Throughout his dynamic business career, he has worked within the Fortune 500 company Colgate-Palmolive as a corporate manager, division controller, and senior executive of business planning. He founded the Edwards Companies in 1991, finding success with Eagle Snacks and the franchising of Taco Bell, KFC, Pizza Hut, Subway, and Shell Petroleum Products. The Edwards Companies owned and operated 40 franchises in Chicago and Michigan. Committed to the communities where they do business, the Edwards Companies has participated in several philanthropic and charitable activities, receiving the recognition from the Chamber of Commerce. Mr. Edwards was appointed to the Michigan Natural Resources Commission by Governor Engler in 1996 and served through 2001. He was honored as the first African-American member to serve on the Michigan Department of Natural Resources. Mr. Edwards was also the chairman of the North Carolina Entrepreneurship Center and works closely with North Carolina A&T to develop their entrepreneurship program. Let's learn more about Mr. Edwards.
While raising three children with Margot, Edwards worked for several companies and eventually Anheuser-Busch, where he put his belief in his dreams to the test. He came up with a plan to manufacture soft drink cans to other companies.
I'll never forget presenting directly to August Bush a plan that I had, a vision that I had, that would get them to where they wanted to be. So he quickly told me after I'd given my presentation with all the numbers and the justification for doing it. He said, Edwards, if you think this is such a good idea, go out and get me my first can contract. Well, I put my papers away and packed up and went out, and I did just that.
Edwards was instrumental in creating the company billions of dollars in revenue as a result. Years later, he moved his family, wife Margot, daughters Tara, Kelly, and son Lee, to Metro Detroit. It became a distributor for a long list of foods, including Eagle Snacks and Famous Amos Cookies.
I was looking very aggressively at coming in and acquire one of their Eagle Snack wholesalerships, and which I did, which was in Detroit, Michigan.
But Edwards had bigger plans. He went on to own 40 Taco Bells and KFCs and several Shell gas stations.
It's very labor intensive, very brand focused, very popular items, very profitable. And it really took us into another element of the game.
In 2004, he bought that beer distributorship he always wanted in Twin Falls, Idaho, selling a large variety of beer, including the Miller Coors portfolio of beverages, as well as Heineken, Corona, Modelo, and Boston Beer, just to name a few, and more than 100 top-selling wines, including Gallo, Sutterholm, and Kendall Jackson. Within time, he had acquired distributorships in all of southern and eastern Idaho, merging the companies into Tech Distributing of Idaho. Most importantly, he always made it a priority to give back and has received many honors and awards from state institutions and legislators.
I've been involved then is the Entrepreneurship Center at both universities, North Carolina A&T and also the University of North Carolina Greensboro, in terms of helping students understand entrepreneurship.
Edwards and his wife now have 4 grandchildren. Spending quality time with his family is one thing he treasures most.
We love our papa so much. And he's the best papa ever.
Another thing of the highest importance to him is to provide generational wealth, so his children and grandchildren can step on his shoulders to see the world from a view most people can never imagine, and empowering young Black aspiring entrepreneurs and students to never give up on your dreams.
To whom much is given, much is expected, and I've always felt the need as well as the goal of doing just that.
In all of the success Edwards has achieved, being inducted into the NBCA Hall of Fame comes full circle. For this proud Aggie, it's priceless. It's a journey and a dream he hopes can inspire others.
The purpose-driven life has a lot of religious connotations to it. It has the type of thing that is inspired, a life inspired by God and the belief in God. A life that is inspired by giving back to people. You can't accomplish things unless you have people and organizations to do that. And then divine in a sense that opportunities pop up. It's amazing.
Inductee this evening is the Honorable Justice Robert Benham. Justice Benham is the first African American appointed and the longest serving member of the Supreme Court of Georgia. Justice Benham served as Chief Justice from 1995 to 2000. Prior to his appointment to the Supreme Court, Justice Benham served on the Georgia Court of Appeals for 5 years. He graduated from Tuskegee University in 1967 with a Bachelor of Science in Political Science, received his Juris Doctorate from the University of Georgia in 1970, and earned a Master of Laws degree from the University of Virginia in 1989. After completing law school, Justice Benham served in the U.S. Army Reserve, attaining the rank of captain. He also served as Special Assistant Attorney General and enjoyed 2 terms as the president of the Bartow County Bar Association. Next up, we have our first lifetime achievement inductee, Mr. Leonard Spring. Mr. Springs is a successful businessman, community leader, and advocate of diversity and inclusion. He has held numerous leadership positions in the banking industry for over 27 years. He currently serves on the board of directors for M&F Bank and is the chairman of M&F's Corporate Marketing Committee. He has also served on the NAACP National Board of Directors and is the founding president of the Greater Charlotte Chapter of the 100 Black Men of America, Incorporated. Mr. Springs has faithfully served on the Board of Trustees of Allen University, Elizabeth City State University, Florida Memorial College, and several other HBCUs. Mr. Springs was appointed a senior advisor for the Department of Education, FSA, for Minority Serving and Under-Resourced Schools Division. He provides support to HBCUs, Hispanic-serving institutions, and tribal colleges and universities. In addition to this, Mr. Springs works with all of the White House initiatives for higher education.
Good evening. I'm Lenny Springs, 1968 graduate of Voorhees College. I am honored tonight to be elected to the National Black College Hall of Fame. But first, let me thank Dr. Evans and the entire family at Voorhees College for nominating me for this honor. Secondly, let me thank my good friend Tommy Deutsch and the National Black College Hall of Fame Board of Directors for selecting me to the Hall of Fame. I'm not here tonight to talk about my accomplishments, but I'm here tonight just to have a little conversation with you. Ladies and gentlemen, these are difficult days that we're living in. Our HBCUs are struggling financially. I challenge all of the honorees tonight, and I congratulate you tonight, other honorees, but I challenge you and all alumni to give back to your college. Our college needs your help. Our college needs your uplift. Write a check and give back to your college. If you can't write a check, go on the campus and volunteer. Spend your time. Time is money. Secondly, mentor somebody. Find a young man, a young lady that you can mentor and spend time with. The fact of the matter, my friends, I am here tonight simply because someone mentored me. When I was a freshman at Voorhees College, Dr. John F. Potts, the president, mentored me. He saw something in me that I did not see in myself. It was his mentoring, his encouragement, his wisdom, and his love for me that made me the person that I am now. Also, I challenge you tonight to do something in your community. Give back to your community. Our communities are suffering tonight. We need to be more involved in our communities. Lift up our community by using your expertise, your talent, and giving back to our communities. Thirdly, ladies and gentlemen, let us all keep the late, great Congressman John Lewis dream alive. Let us all register, but more so let us all go out to vote on November the 3rd. Let's vote for those candidates that have our interests in mind, our interests as an African-American community. Let's vote and encourage others to vote on November the 3rd. So let me finally say that again, thank you, Voorhees College, for nominating me. Thank you, National Black College Hall of Fame, for selecting my nomination and honoring me tonight. So I am honored to be here. I will continue to try to be a voice in this community. And finally, let us all be safe.
Our second Lifetime Achievement honoree this evening is Dr. Jimmie Jackson. Dr. Jackson attained her Bachelor of Science degree in mathematics from Savannah State College in 1959. After completing postgraduate studies at the University of Tennessee, she continued her teaching career in the D.C. public school system for the next 42 years. A few of her outstanding accomplishments include her 1974 proposal for open space settings through the D.C. public school system, which resulted in the very first open space school. In 1977, Dr. Jackson developed a project designed to meet professional development needs of D.C. public school teachers. This resulted in the D.C. Teacher Center Grant, which funded over $3 million in its first year. In 1980, she designed yet another innovative program, the Dial-A-Teacher Homework Hotline. Dr. Jackson was also elected president of the Washington Teachers Union, the first female in the organization's history. She is a leading member of the Sigma Gamma Rho Sorority, Incorporated, National Council on Educating Black Children, and was the president of the National Alumni Association of Savannah State College.
My beloved Savannah State University, we say you can get anywhere from here. It has been my honor and privilege to serve my great alma mater, the College by the Sea, since the first day I stepped on campus, this beautiful campus in 1955, from my hometown of Hainesville, Georgia. I have been and will continue to be committed to its mission of educating and nurturing future generations. My parents, Inez and Jimmie Colson, want a more abundant life for me and my siblings. Savannah State College granted that for me. I thank Interim President Dr. Kimberly Ballard Washington, Dr. Cheryl Dozier, and Dr. Annie Brock for their tireless efforts to maintain the high regard of Savannah State. My service to Savannah State has been a journey of love. HBCUs will survive if we are intentional about giving our time, our talent, and our treasures. It is only right to give back to HBCUs what they have so generously bestowed upon us by way of a stellar education. I will wave the banner of Savannah State University and all HBCUs for their steadfast determination as they continue to thrive for years to come. Thank you.
Let's give another round of applause for our Lifetime Achievement honorees. Ladies and gentlemen, we have come to our final honoree of the evening. I am so honored to present for induction into the National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame, Dr. Gwendolyn Boyd. Dr. Boyd is receiving the Chairman's Award. She's an engineer, dynamic leader, prolific motivational speaker, a preacher, and a prominent advocate for STEM education. A native of Montgomery, Alabama, she received a full scholarship to Alabama State University, where she graduated with a degree in mathematics, physics, and music. She went on to be the first African-American female to earn a master's degree in mechanical engineering at Yale University. Dr. Boyd's career at the Johns Hopkins University Applied Physics Laboratory was highlighted by exemplary leadership and dedicated service to engineering teams. She eventually became the assistant for development programs and executive assistant to the chief of staff. She also served on the Johns Hopkins Diversity Leadership Council and served as chair from 2001 to 2013. Dr. Boyd is a nationally known champion of education and was nominated by President Barack Obama in 2009 to serve as a trustee to the Barry M. Goldwater Scholarship and Excellence in Education Foundation. She was also appointed to serve on the President's Advisory Commission on Educational Excellence for African Americans in 2014 by President Obama. Dr. Boyd served as the 14th and first female president of Alabama State University from 2014 to 2017. And during her leadership, she obtained the university's first engineering degree program. Dr. Boyd is also a minister and ordained itinerant elder in the African Methodist Episcopal Church. Reverend Dr. Boyd has received numerous awards for her contributions to the community, such as the Carver Medal from Simpson College, Chancellor's Award from North Carolina Central University, and several congressional, city, and state recognitions.
Greetings to our HBCU family. My name is Gwendolyn Boyd, and I'm humbled to be selected by the National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame Foundation as a 2020 inductee into the Hall of Fame. As a product of two HBCUs, my life is a testimony of the power and impact HBCUs can have on your life and on your career. And that is why I have and always will continue to use every available platform to promote the extraordinary educational viability of HBCUs. And whether you graduated from an HBCU or not, there is a need for all of us to continue to sustain their history, promote their culture, and honor their excellence. Again, I thank you for this great honor.
Please welcome the founder of the National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame, Thomas Dortch Jr.
Thank you, Monica. Phenomenal job as usual. And I'd like to, at this time, say to all of our inductees, thank you for all that you've done throughout the communities. You make us proud, and you show the world why historically black colleges and universities are so important. I want to also thank our phenomenal corporate partners who've been with us over the years. I want to thank Delta Airlines, the Georgia Pacific Foundation, and Wells Fargo. Thank you for your corporate partnerships. We couldn't do it without you. And your investment in the Hall of Fame has provided scholarships, training, and opportunities to our alumni, to our students, and college administrators. Thank you so much. And so I simply challenge all of us, during these times of COVID-19, our HBCUs have so many challenges, but we can make the difference. We have to make sure that we have safe environments for our students. We have to make sure that they have the resources that are there, that are needed to help keep these great institutions strong and open. And more importantly, we need to make sure that the future leaders of these nations that we see here in America and across the world, that these leaders are going to be strong, and I guarantee you, an education from an HBCU will prepare them. I hope you've enjoyed this weekend and all of our power forums and induction ceremonies and the Legacy of Leaders Award. We look to see you next year, but remember every day, get up and do something for somebody and help to make this nation and the world a better place for all. Thank you.
Thanks, Tommy. What an extraordinary night. History makers were honored and inspiring stories were told. One thing is certain, black college alumni have changed the world. We intend to have an in-person induction ceremony to be held in March of 2021 if the COVID-19 pandemic guidelines will allow it. If not, we'll see you next year for the 36th celebration of the National Black College Alumni Hall of Fame. Good night.